So just a quick note for any freshmen here who are hoping to get like FYI points or something, Ashley right there will get you in the back, so you can just give your name to her after your next. So thank you all for coming out. My name is Boyd Hussein and I'm vice president for the Bucknell Conservative Club. Tonight is my distinct honor to introduce the student Nessusa. He's one of the leading conservative thinkers in America. He's currently president of King's College, a New York Times bestselling author, and the director of the second highest grossing political documentary, 2016, Obama's America. I would like to thank Bucknell University for hosting this event, as well as the financial help of the Young Americans Foundation, the Bucknell Libertarian Alliance, and the Bucknell Conservative Club. Thank you once again for coming out. Here in Missouri, Dinesh Sidna.
Will this American exceptionalism, will this American unique uniqueness continue to shape our world. By the way, for a moment, it's worth thinking about this concept of American exceptionalism. Barack Obama was asked about it in 2009. Do you believe that America is an exceptional country? And Obama said, well, I believe in American exceptionalism just as the Brits believe in British exceptionalism and the Greeks in Greek exceptionalism. So what Obama's kind of saying is, well, listen, well, every country thinks they're exceptional. Therefore, in a sense, no one really is. But it's kind of worth asking for just a moment, what is it that makes the United States exceptional? What makes it different than any other country? Now, I want to mention a couple of things because they tie right into Obama and what I take to be his critique of American exceptionalism, or rather, the fact that against the American dream, he offers a different dream. Now, one of the things that's exceptional about America is that it is a country that is not based on birth or blood. What I mean by that is that as I look around the room, most of you can come to India, my native country, you can live there, you can work there, you can take Indian citizenship, but actually there is no way for you to become Indian. Why? Because to be Indian, you need two things. You need brown skin and Indian parents. Being Indian is a function of birth and blood. And actually, so it is in most countries in the world. But here in the United States, no. You can come here, and in fact, over the centuries, over the years, the Irish, the Italians, the Jews, but now the Koreans, the West Indians, the Pakistanis. And sometimes it takes a couple of generations, but you can actually become American. And that is one of the unique distinguishing features of America. Here's another distinguishing feature of America. This is a country that is not a traditional empire, but what Jefferson calls an empire of ideals. In other words, the idea here is that America doesn't go abroad, as the British did, the French did, to conquer and rule, but America offers a recipe to the world. And the idea is that if you like the recipe, you can adopt it. America is not a traditional empire. A third feature of American exceptionalism I want to stress is America is an entrepreneurial society at its core. Now, what I mean by this is that the idea of entrepreneurship, of business, has always been a very positive force from the very beginning in America. By the way, if you look at the American Constitution and you look at the text of the Constitution before the Bill of Rights was added, it only talks about one right, the right to patents and copyrights. Entrepreneurial skills are at the core of the American experience. By the way, this is unique because of the rest of the world, historically. Even in Europe, entrepreneurship, trade, the merchant, these were reviled activities. If you pick up the Analects of Confucius, it says, noble people know what is virtuous. The low man knows what is profitable. So you have this sort of derision of profit. In India, the caste system, who's at the top? The Brahmin, the priest. Below him, the Kshatriya, the warrior, the aristocrats, the kings. And down the list you go, where really close to the bottom, just one rung above from the hated untouchable, is the Vaishya, the merchant, the trader. The Islamic historian Ibn Khaldun has an essay in which he discusses the following question: which is a more noble way to get wealth, trade or looting? He weighs the two and decides that clearly a more legitimate way to acquire stuff is looting. Why? Because he says trade is a little bit effeminate. He says in trade you have to take advantage of the wants and needs of others. You're kind of exploiting something low in human nature. He says looting is very manly. Because in looting you've got to fight a guy in open combat, defeat him, and then take his stuff. So looting plays on the manly virtue of courage. Now, I'm being a little facetious. grants today, by and large, inherited money is better than earned money. Why? Because if you inherit it, you didn't have to do anything corrupt to get it. If you earned it, you probably ran over a whole bunch of people. And so there's a sort of stigma that's attached to the nouveau riche. So these are, I mention this because these are some of the distinguishing features of American exceptionalism. And this exceptional country has taken 200 years to build, to reach its current position. And the big question now is, how long is this American era going to last? It seems to be sort of winding down. The IMF predicts that in a few years, the Chinese economy will become the largest in the world. Now look, decline is a feature of great nations. Countries go up and countries come down. But the question I want to raise is it possible that in the United States today, we have a leader, a president, who is not the presiding instrument of decline, but is in fact the primary architect of it? Is it possible that we have in the White House a leader who wants decline, who's actually an advocate of it and a practitioner of it, who is actually attempting to wind down the American era? Now, this idea, by the way, is a little bit heretical even among conservatives, because there are conservatives and Republicans who say, wait a minute, Obama is a bungler. He's an amateur, in the title of a recent book. He wants to do X, but he gets Y. And the question I'm raising, or the argument I'm going to make tonight, is no. Obama is not getting results different than what he intends. Or rather, he intends the results he's getting. Obama actually has an agenda. And the agenda is ultimately to transform America. Obama's own words, by the way. In his inaugural speech, he used the phrase, remaking America. But how do you remake something? How do you remake a bridge? Well, you have to take down the bridge that's there now. You remake America by first unmaking America. Now, the questions obviously arise, what are you saying? Is Obama a traitor? Is he a Manchurian candidate? Is he a secret Muslim? Is he being manipulated by some crazy cabal? Why would somebody want to do this? It would be almost like we're the Lakers, the Los Angeles Lakers, or the Pittsburgh Steelers, and we hired a coach who's calling plays for our team to lose. Why would someone do that? I don't think you can even begin to settle this debate. Is Obama an amateur or not? Who is Obama? Without getting to what Obama's underlying concept is. What is his underlying ideology? And before we even talk about that, it's really important to realize that Obama is the most mysterious man in modern history to occupy the White House. It's surprising enough that 4 years later, 4 years ago, much about him wasn't known, but it is nothing short of astounding that now large areas of his biography are just black holes. Now, I'm not talking about the birther issue of where he was born. Obama transferred very mysteriously from Occidental College to Columbia University, even though no Ivy League college permits those kinds of transfers. They're very protective of their degrees. Nobody knows how Obama got to Columbia. What were his SAT scores for getting into college? Unknown. What was his GPA at Columbia? Unknown. He wrote a thesis. What was it about? What's in it? Unknown. The New York Times tried to find a single person who knew Obama at Columbia. Even one. Who took a class with him, ate with him, roomed with him. To date, no such person has been identified, and Obama refuses to name any. Who were his girlfriends? Unknown. He says he had multiple. None of them have been interviewed. David Marin names one, but she doesn't can even agree on who Obama is. Remember, this is not the case with other people. George Bush, like him, hate him, we do know where he's coming from. Jimmy Carter, Ronald Reagan, Bill Clinton, we get it. But with Obama, even on the left, you hear, on the one hand, he's a great progressive. But on the other hand, from the same camp, no, he's a sellout to Wall Street. And also from the left, he's the realization of Martin Luther King's dream. He's the first African-American president. But then you talk to Cornel West, Tavis Smiley, other black leaders, they're like, Obama's not really black. He never sat at a segregated lunch counter. And neither did any of his ancestors. He's not descended from slaves. Where's his African-American experience? He was born in Hawaii, lived 4 years in Indonesia. So right away we see that not just on the right, but on the left, there is a sort of a puzzle about Obama that no one has really been able to unravel. And then there is, I would say, the deeper mystery of Obama's actions. Obama does stuff that makes no sense, and no one on the right or the left can explain it. And so people literally just stare. I'd like to give a very current recent example of this, and it has to do with what's going on in the Middle East right now, the so-called Arab Spring. As you know, there have been uprisings in about a dozen countries in the Middle East, a kind of democratic awakening, if you will, in the Middle East. And yet if you watch Obama, I'm not saying Obama caused it, he certainly didn't, but if you watch his response to it, it's downright puzzling. And I want to highlight that puzzle by talking about, first, the contrast between Libya and Syria. And then second, the contrast between Obama's actions in Egypt versus Iran. So let's talk first for a moment about Libya and Syria. As you remember, there was an uprising in Benghazi, and Obama goes, I've got to intervene. Genocide is happening in Libya. Number of people killed in Benghazi at that time, 250. Genocide. In comes NATO, airstrikes, bombardments, Gaddafi's killed, injected, new regime in Libya. Meanwhile, for now, almost the better part of a year, well over 10,000 people have been massacred on the street in Syria by the dictator Assad. Obama's actions? Let's not help him. No military aid, no NATO, no airstrikes. In fact, Obama for many months was reluctant to give any aid at all, even humanitarian aid. Now he's sending a few walkie-talkies so the rebels can talk to each other. But my point is Obama intervenes in Libya, but won't intervene when much greater loss of life and casualties, and the world is in an uproar, but he won't do it. Now we switch to Egypt, where Obama was a great friend of democracy. Oh, we realize that if Mubarak is ejected, we might get the Muslim Brotherhood, but we Americans believe in democracy. So we've got to support the protesters in Tahrir Square. They're going to have a free election. And we've just got to recognize the legitimacy of the new government. By the way, recently there's now a power struggle going on in Egypt between the military and the Muslim Brotherhood. Obama is decisively on the side of the Muslim Brotherhood. He is sending cables to the Egyptian military, you step aside and turn over power to those guys, or we're going to cut off USA. This is widely reported. You can Google it. So Obama's actions here are, you might say, decisively on behalf of democracy, even if that democracy results in the rise to power of the largest organization of radical Islam in the world, namely the Muslim Brotherhood. We're going to, apparently, live with it. And you might say again that Obama is compelled to do this because we Americans have democratic ideals, except that a year earlier in Iran, there were even bigger demonstrations than Tahrir Square, well over 1 million people on the street protesting a rigged Iranian election. And that was the demand that Ayatollah step aside and that there be a new government in Iran. Obama's actions were very instructive. We are not going to get involved. We are going to stay out of it. We're going to let the Iranians settle their own issues. And sure enough, the mullahs brought out the military, they brought out the police, they defeated the uprising, and that was that. So, my question A moratorium on drilling following the oil spill, that's perhaps understandable. Delaying the Keystone pipeline, Canadian oil flowing through America causing more jobs, tens of thousands of jobs, a little bit more strange. Keeping large areas of America off limits, then agreeing to drilling but using regulatory obstacles to block any actual drilling. And again, people say on the right and the left, well, you know, Obama, he must have sort of caught the Al Gore bug. He's just an environmentalist. You know Al Gore. The earth has a fever. Global warming. And it looks like that's Obama. He's captive to the environmental lobby. Except that if you actually watch Obama when he is abroad, he sounds like a veritable evangelist of oil drilling. He loves it. He's always talking it up. And he's using taxpayer money through the Export-Import Bank to fund the oil drilling in other countries. He's giving money to Brazil, to Colombia, to Mexico to drill for oil. Not for that oil to come here. You could say, clever Obama, he's going to let them face the environmental risk. No, we get the oil. No, they get the oil. By the way, when I recorded this in the film, and Obama himself comes out blasting. By the way, I love this. It's kind of a thrill for me to be attacked by name by the President of the United States.
You want to know why people don't like America? People, well, because of Islam. Well, even if that was true,
It could only explain anti-Americanism in the Middle East, but it couldn't possibly explain anti-Americanism in Asia or South America or Africa outside the Muslim world. So anti-colonialism is a very important idea. We need to be more familiar with it, quite apart from Obama. So what is the core idea of anti-colonialism? The core idea of anti-colonialism, which seems shocking, but when you think about it, makes made common sense for a whole generation of people all over the world. Made common sense for my dad and his dad and my uncles. The core idea of anti-colonialism is that people become wealthy and countries become wealthy by stealing from other people. The central idea of anti-colonialism is theft. Why do people live better in Paris and London than they do in Nairobi or Mumbai? Answer: the British came and ruled Kenya for 90 years, and ruled India for 250 years, and stole the raw materials. So the wealth of the West has been ripped off from the non-West. How do people become wealthy in any country? They do it by taking other people's stuff. Barack Obama Sr., in a famous paper written in 1965, when I say famous, made famous by me, really, because it wasn't reported anywhere, but it's kind of a notable paper, because in that paper he talks about the possibility of, quote, 100% tax rates. 100% tax rates. Now, to any economist or any Bucknell economics major, you might think, well, that's just nuts. Why would you tax people at 100%? Who would possibly have any incentive to work if you're taxed all you make? But the anti-colonial idea, when you put it in, explains it. And that is that if wealth is acquired by theft, you have to give it back. If one of you came to my house and stole all my furniture, what's the proper tax rate for you? 100%. Because it's not your furniture. You can't say, well, giving up the furniture will reduce my incentive to work. It's not your furniture. Fast forward, by the way, a little bit to Barack Obama, President Obama, speaking to American business. You didn't build that. What's he saying? Society creates wealth. Greedy entrepreneurs then swoop in and grab it. But it's not theirs. They have no right to it. The government has every right to come and take it. And the government isn't really taking it from you because it's not yours in the first place. It doesn't belong to you. That is the underlying logic of you didn't build that. So theft is the core idea of anti-colonialism. Now, many people think, this may all be very interesting, but how on earth could Obama have gotten these ideas from his dad? He didn't know his dad. And that is true, but the person who transmitted these ideas to Obama was a real multiculturalist, American-born, his mom. This is Ann Obama. Ann Obama is actually, in my earlier book, The Roots of Obama's Rage, I kind of missed the significance of Ann Obama. Obama, President Obama, camouflages it. He presents Ann Obama as someone who sort of never really had any thoughts for herself, but just liked to do things like pick flowers and stare at the moon. So I thought, she can't be that important. I'll focus on the dad. But now when you learn more about the mom, you realize that she was a quite powerful and remarkable woman. First of all, when I call her a multiculturalist, part of my topic today, multiculturalism and Obama, is generally on a campus, being a multiculturalist is a little bit of a joke. And what I mean by that is that there's no serious multiculturalism on the American campus. Multiculturalism on the American campus is stuff like eating Mexican food. Or showing at the most, a cocktail party familiarity with non-Western ideas, but no real engagement with those ideas, which are never taken seriously at all. So, Ann Obama wasn't like that. She actually decided that she didn't like America, and she would leave it and never return. And so when Barack Obama, her husband, dumped her, and she was looking for a third world anti-American guy, and she found him, but he didn't want her. So what did she do? She went and found another third world anti-American guy from Indonesia and moved there. back to the United States permanently to live. She actually spent much of her life in small villages in Indonesia studying hand and handicrafts. In some ways, you have to admire her. She was a real multiculturalist. She spoke the language, etc. But the bottom line of it also was that she shared the ideology of Barack Obama Sr. And even when she knew his flaws as a man, Barack Obama Sr. was truly one of the weirdest men this side of the Nile. First of all, he was a polygamist who had four wives and eight known children. He was a chronic alcoholic. He looked after no one in his family. He was also a famous liar and imposter. He literally, when he worked for the Kenyan government, he'd go to conferences, UN conferences, and he'd say, well, you know, I'm the minister of planning for Kenya. They'd be like, oh, well, come to the VIP reception. Well, 15 minutes later, the real guy would show up, and they'd turn him away as an imposter. So finally, all of this caught up with Barack Obama Sr., and he was fired from most of his jobs, and then he got drunk in 1982 and drove his car into a tree, and this was the tragic end of Obama's dad. So he's a very odd guy to make your role model. And Obama knew all this, by the way. But even though she didn't admire him as a man, she admired his ideals. And there's, in the film, a sort of climactic scene where Obama himself goes to his father's grave. And by the way, a lot of people who see our film, a surprising number, come out feeling a little sorry for Obama. We get all kinds of people who say, you know what, I understand Obama better. I feel sorry for the guy. He has, as they say, issues. But I'm not sure that I want him working out his issues on stage.
Right.
Muslim. I was on a radio show the other day, and someone said, is he a Muslim? And I said, well, he'd probably be a better man than he was. But Obama isn't a Muslim. His father was an atheist. His mom was an atheist. His stepfather, Lola Socorro, was an atheist. So Obama was raised completely without religion. But he happened to work in Chicago with the churches, Catholic and Protestant. And the pastors and the priests would say to him, hey, Obama, well, where do you go to church? And of course, Obama would have a heart because he didn't go. So finally, one of his Alinsky buddies said to him, Obama, this looks bad. You have to pretend to go. So go check out this Trinity Church in Chicago and see if you like it. And Obama, in his book, describes when he goes there, he said, I'm walking on the lawn, and I see a big sign, and it says, Free South Africa. This is what actually piques Obama's interest, because Obama's just come back from Kenya. And so he's got this global perspective. He's looking at America bifocally, from the inside, from the outside, and he sees Free South Africa, he goes, wow. He goes in, he sees this guy in a dashiki African outfit, and he's talking about what? He's talking about the world. He's talking about the fact that we took this country from the Indians. We took it from the Navajo, the Cherokee, the Arapaho. We bombed Grenada, we bombed Libya, we killed Gaddafi's kid. We supported the apartheid regime of South Africa. We dropped atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and then of course the culmination, goddamn America. And here we get, I would argue, the second big idea of anti-colonialism. The first one I mentioned earlier, theft. Here's the second one. That the real problem in the world, the rogue nation, is America. Why? Because America has inherited the baton of Western leadership from Europe ever since World War II. We are the bad guys. And so the job of the anti-colonialist is not to put the reins on Iran or North Korea, but to actually put the reins on us, on America. So now we look at some actions of Obama that I want to focus on. The first one is Obama's weird behavior in the area of nuclear weapons. Obama, as you know, has been working really hard to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear bomb. How has he been doing it? First of all, he has been offering them some very stern advice not to build a bomb. Second, he laboriously collects UN signatures on the topic. Third, he imposes the kind of weak sanctions that he knows in advance are going to be vetoed by Iraq, by Russia and China. So in effect, he does nothing that could even be reasonably calculated to stop the mullahs from building a bomb. By the way, the mullahs very much want to build a bomb. Being a bomb makes you top dog in the Middle East immediately. Old joke, what do you call a dictator who has nuclear weapons? Answer, sir. That's why the Iranians want a bomb. Now, since Obama has been rather lackadaisical about Iran building a bomb, you might think that Obama doesn't particularly care about the proliferation of nuclear weapons. But actually, he does. He's very worried about it. But the nuclear weapons whose proliferation he wants to stop are our nuclear weapons. And those weapons, Obama has in fact been acting very diligently and very successfully to reduce. So while Obama has been unable to stop the Iranians going from zero to one, or North Korea from adding to its nuclear stockpile, Obama has reduced the American arsenal dramatically from 5,000 nuclear warheads when he came in, down to 1,500 by the START treaty. He's asked the Pentagon to study going down to 300. That's how many bombs the Chinese have, by the way. And he also talks about a world free of nuclear weapons. Except that nobody else cares about that. The Chinese are modernizing their arsenal. So in fact, the only nuclear weapons that Obama can produce are America's. That's the one nuclear stockpile that he controls. So what is Obama doing here? Why would somebody do this? Can you see Bill Clinton slashing American nuclear superiority? Ridiculous. I would argue that the anti-colonial explanation explains this in a way that no other theory does. Obama's leveling the global nuclear playing field. Why should America have more bombs? What gives us the right? What makes a bomb Arab Spring, and Obama's apparent double standard that, as I said, no one has really explained. Use military force in Libya, but not in Syria. Support democracy in Egypt, but not in Iran. Why? The simple way to analyze it is to ask yourself this question. What did the dictators who have been pushed out have in common? And what do the regimes that are still there have in common? Well, it turns out that the dictators who have been pushed out have this in common. They are either allies of or doing business with the United States. Mubarak was our greatest ally in the region, not counting Israel. He's out. Replacing him is a regime that is indisputably more anti-Israel and more anti-American. Gaddafi, not our ally, but since 2002 he's been doing business with America. Outing terrorists, paying reparations for the Lockerbie bomber, he's out. We don't exactly know what's come replacing him in Libya, but chances are that the new regime is going to be more unfavorable to us than Gaddafi was, at least in his well-behaved phase. And now we turn to the guys who are entrenched, who Obama refuses to take action to dislodge. And who are they? In Syria, Assad, our enemy, sponsor of Hezbollah, other terrorist groups, and the mullahs in Iran, our deadly enemy, in fact, allied with Assad. So now we come to a rather disturbing question. Why would the President of the United States act deliberately? The key word here is deliberately. I want to contrast for just a moment Obama's behavior now with Jimmy Carter's in 1979. In 1979, by the way, Jimmy Carter did pull American support for an ally, the Shah, and we got Khomeini. But if you look back at that history, how did Jimmy Carter do that? And the answer was that Jimmy Carter was indeed a bungler. He was indeed an amateur. He came in championing human rights. His people told him the Shah is a dictator. And then Carter said, I support human rights. The Shah is a dictator. Time to pull the Persian rug out from under him. And so we withdraw American support of the Shah. And who do we get? Khomeini. This is called violating the principle of the lesser evil. In trying to get rid of the bad guy, try to make sure you don't get the worst guy. But this is a classic case of, you could call it presidential nincompoopery. Bungling in the cosmic scale. But that's not Obama. When Obama warns the Egyptian military to step aside and turn over power, he knows full well that the Muslim Brotherhood is going to inherit that power. He's not naive about it. It's in his daily briefing. So, back to my question. Why would the President of the United States deliberately undermine our allies and strengthen or not worry if our adversaries gain power? And my answer can be given in a single sentence, and it's prescribed by the anti-colonial ideology, and that is, you want to put the leash on America. You want to reduce America's footprint in the world. Why? Because you think America has been stepping on the world. So it's important to see here that we're not saying that Obama hates America. We're not saying that he's a secret Muslim. No, he subscribes to an ideology that would like to see America go down so the rest of the world can come up. He's a global redistributionist, and he's attempting a global redistribution of wealth and power. When Obama talks about the 1% and the 99%, he doesn't just mean in America, he means worldwide. And remember that if you're thinking globally, all of America, the whole country, is the 1%. And there are 99 hungry nations encircling America that want to have our wealth, our standard of living, our global influence, and so on. Ultimately, Obama believes in reparations. But it's not racial reparations. It's global reparations. If you look at Obama's mission, it's really a kind of heroic one. You have to admire it, even if you don't agree with it. Because it is a mission that no man in modern history has ever attempted. Essentially, I think what Obama is trying to do is right the ship of the world that, in his opinion, has been wrong side up for half a millennium. We have been living in, on campuses in the multicultural Eurocentrism. What does Eurocentrism mean, putting Europe or the West at the center of the world? But guess what? We have for 500 years been living in a Eurocentric world. Why? Because the West had the wealth and the power to conquer the rest of the world and put itself at the center. Obama wants to undo that. He wants to put the world, as he sees it, right side up, which is end the age of Western dominance, finish off the age of American superiority, and globally redistribute wealth and power. That's why today, by the way, wealth is not so much in groundnuts or corn, energy. Energy is the key to countries coming up in the world. The reason Obama's a global energy redistributor is he thinks we've developed enough. It's now time for the Indians and the Chinese and the Indonesians and the Brazilians and the Colombians and the Mexicans. So let me wrap it up a little bit with this thought. The reason that the message of our film is subversive in a way is if the thesis that I've argued very briefly here tonight is believed and true, I believe that Obama will be alienated from his own constituency. Even Democrats will not vote for Obama if this is what he actually wants to do. And Obama knows this. So then you have to ask, what's going on here? Why in the media is there such a reluctance to cover this topic? I think the short answer is that there is a widespread belief in the press that it is morally urgent for the racial reputation of this country that Obama be reelected. That this is a referendum on American racial goodness. That if Obama's defeated, America will be seen as a residually racist country. And therefore, everything and anything must be done to re-elect Obama, including suppressing any harmful information that comes out against him. Certainly no one's going looking for it. I mean, look at a small scene in the film, right? Which is the scene involving George Obama. Some of you might know, this is after the film, that I was in my apartment and I get a phone call from Kenya. I pick up the phone, it's George. I met George Obama a few months earlier in Nairobi. And George Obama says, this is the youngest brother of Barack Obama, 30 years old. And he has a 2-year-old, sick, and is at the hospital. And George says, Dinesh, I need some help. My kid is sick, he has a chest condition. Can you please send me $1,000? And I said, George, I had George in the slum, and he's a street smart guy. So I'm like, George, are you telling the truth? You know, he's like, yeah, I'm at the hospital. Okay, well, hand the phone to the nurse. And then I verified that this was true. So I said, George, okay, I'll send you my Western Union $1,000, but before I let you go, let me ask you this. Isn't there somebody else you can call? George goes, no. George goes, and then he adds this, and this was the crush. He goes, Dinesh, you're like a brother to me. Think about this. The president's brother is at a hospital where his 2-year-old kid needs health care. And Barack Obama, not just president, not just multimillionaire, but the guy, the centerpiece of whose whole election campaign is our obligations to the needy. One of Obama's favorite phrases on the campaign trail, we are our brother's keeper. He said it more than 50 times. And yet here's his own brother living in the Haruma slum on a few dollars a month, and Obama refuses to contribute one penny to help him. By the way, this article, I first wrote about this in 2009. It's not like Obama doesn't know. He knows, but won't. So, what I'm getting at is simply this. Let's put aside this thing. If Mitt Romney had a half-brother who was living in a slum, wouldn't this be on the cover of Newsweek? Wouldn't this be on the front page of the New York Times, reported on every network? This would be the biggest story in the country. So where are we? Where we are now is an important election. The Romney campaign is focusing pretty narrowly. Obama's a nice guy, Obama's a decent guy, but he has the wrong ideas. Unfortunately, very few people in America are asking, who is Obama? Who actually is the man behind the mask? Because we know it's a mask, right? I mean, just go back and listen to those speeches in 2004 and 2008. A I'll be a healer. I'll be a unifier. I'll be a centrist. I mean, I think looking back, we can see that that was a camouflage. But where is the real Obama? He's still kind of unknown. So I think this is a time when we need vigilance on the part of the American citizens to find out the facts and disseminate them. Because ultimately, to me, as an immigrant, it's the American dream itself that is at stake. And what's that dream all about? It's ultimately about a country where you rise according to your talents. It's a dream that looks at America as, on the balance, America's made mistakes, as a force for liberty in the world. And I, for one, don't want that American dream to be set aside for anyone else's dream, let alone the dream of Obama and his father. Thank you very much.
Is the fact that people leave the film and whatever their politics, they go, wow,
I just know a whole lot about Barack Obama that I didn't know 90 minutes ago. And what's most telling about the film, and what the facts that are the most telling, often come from Obama's own mouth. So people will come to us and they go, "You guys are really great. Where do you find an actor who sounds so much like Obama?" That is Obama. So having Obama in the film, almost as a co-narrator, is very persuasive. Yes?
Mr. D'Souza, thank you for being here. I wondered if you were interested in doing so, if you could touch on the platitudes of liberalism, because if you look at Nancy Pelosi or Harry Reid in the Senate, you do see sort of a similar discussion of wealth redistribution, and if you want to define it in the 1% versus the 99%, the only plan we've gotten out of the United States Senate is 1% paying 30% more of the tax bill. No discussion of expanding the tax base. And so, not to sound too wonky, but the policy discussion, in my estimation, can only be described through a similar mentality, if you will, of socking it to the rich, making those who earn distribute their earnings among what an elite deems as having been deprived of that.
Yeah, it is true that I think in the mainline Democratic Party, you do have just a kind of a lack of understanding of how wealth is created. So that was initially my take on Obama, that Obama was like that. So I'd say something like, well, Obama has lots of ideas of how to split the pie. But it's never occurred to him, how do you get a pie? Or how do you make a pie grow? Right? But the view of Obama I've been arguing here now is a little bit different. It's that actually what Obama does is he's very skillful at getting people who are coming from a different place than he is to go along with him. And so when Obama blocks oil drilling, the environmentalists jump up and cheer because they think he's one of them. He's not. I don't believe Obama knows or cares if the earth is getting hotter or colder. He's about something different. Similarly, when Obama's slashing on nuclear arsenal, which even Democrats don't want to do, but again, they misunderstand, they go, he dreams of a world free of nuclear weapons. So they think that's what he's doing, the nuclear freeze. They don't realize, no, he's actually not about reducing proliferation, he's just about reducing our proliferation. So this is the skill of Obama. He's able to chameleon-like draw the various Democratic camps toward him. And he makes it impossible to go against them. The reason you can't call him a bungler is he achieved stuff that Bill Clinton couldn't achieve. Bill and Hillary tried healthcare. Obama got it done. If you read Bob Woodward's book, all kinds of people have opposed Obama in the military. The Defense Department, the CIA, the State Department, Hillary Clinton, one by one he defeats them all. So the fallacy of conservatives is to judge Obama by their standards. They say things like, Obama doesn't realize that if you have confiscatory taxation, it will not make the economy grow. That's a great point if that's Obama's goal. What if his goal is not to make the economy grow? It's something else. You're criticizing him for something he's not even attempting to do. So that's the problem. You've got to judge Obama by his standards, not yours. And by that standard, he's very successful. Okay?
Thank you.
Yes?
Given the domestic and foreign weakness that's been brought on partly by Obama and his administration, what problems do you foresee for our next president, Mitt Romney?
Well, if it's Romney, his challenge is going to be cleanup, right? His challenge will be to bring priorities back into line. And it's going to be a tough one. But I also want to say a word about what we face if Obama were reelected. That's the theme of 2016. And here's my worry. Because if you look, for example, at the Middle East, there are actually in that region three important countries. There's Iran, there's Egypt, there's Saudi Arabia. So Iran has been in the hands of the radical Muslims for 30 years. Egypt, we can all see history being made in front of our eyes, is transitioning into the radical Muslim camp with long-term consequences. What's left? Saudi Arabia. So in the second term, if I were to project out the anti-colonial philosophy, what I would do is I would demand that Saudi Arabia have a free election. Why shouldn't the Arab Spring reach Saudi Arabia? I would demand that the royal family put themselves in the ballot against the Muslim Brotherhood or the Mullahs. Let's see who wins. That is, an election would be very difficult for the royal family to win. And if Saudi Arabia falls, then Mecca and Medina go into the hands of the radical Muslims. They control all the three major countries of the region. This is how we begin to approach a term used in the film, the United States of Islam. Some people at the beginning when the film started in July were like, the United States of Islam, and that should be a little bit carried away. But if when you saw the recent uprisings in the Middle East and you did a Google map of where these uprisings were occurring and you were to just draw a border, it would look exactly like the United States of Islam, the map that's actually shown in the film. So, bottom line of it is, I don't know what a Romney presidency would fully look like, but I do think that an Obama presidency would push these trends forward in quite perilous ways for America's capital living and America's influence in the world. Yes, sir.
Hi, I was just wondering, can you talk some specific policies that you think Obama has led to redistribution of wealth in the world? Because that's like colonialism being the discredited, that's like a conspiracy. You didn't really miss any specifics or anything that Obama did directly. I mean, talking about the nuclear arsenal, lowering it, we know what difference does it make if you have 300 or 3,000? Because nuclear weapons are a deterrent report. That's what happened to the Soviet Union. They have 9,000 weapons. Nuclear weapons, but that's not really a thing. Like, the whole world knows our military is the strongest, nobody's done that strong with us. So, just going back to that, saying that, oh, he wants to reduce our nuclear arsenal, that means that he's reducing wealth or anything. I don't know.
Sure. Well, I have an answer. Say a word about nuclear weapons first, because your premise on this is actually just completely wrong. Here's why. A world which has no nuclear weapons would be an extremely dangerous world, right? Because the knowledge of making nuclear weapons would remain. And any country that could build one or five or eight bombs would immediately be in command. So, second, you're saying if we had 300 nuclear bombs, we can destroy every major city and therefore we're safe? No, that's not true. Because if we have, let's imagine that we have 300 nuclear bombs. Let's assume the Chinese have 300, and let's assume the Russians have 300. This seems like a very safe situation. I would maintain it's extremely dangerous. First of all, if the Russians and the Chinese get together they now have 600 bombs. They can launch a first strike with 300 bombs, 300 nuclear warheads, and take out the majority of our 300. They can't take them all out because we've got submarines or we've got bombers. Let's say we have 40 nuclear bombs left. We can destroy every major city in China and Russia, but we never would. Why? Because they would have 150 nuclear bombs each, and they could decimate every American city in a second strike. So their first strike would take out our nuclear bombs, and we would have no incentive to strike back, because if we did, America would be no more. Now, I'm not telling you anything new. I'm just telling you that this is a nuclear strategy that has been known and discussed for 60 years. So it's simply wrong to say that, oh, well, let's have 300 bombs, we're going to be safe. Not true. All right, now back to how is Obama redistributing on a global scale? Well, I mentioned energy, but I want to mention what I think is the single biggest engine of global redistribution. By the way, in 2004, when Obama was in the Senate, he proposed a ridiculously large wealth transfer program from America to the rest of the world. Hundreds of billions of dollars. And it was so laughable that even Democrats would not even take it seriously. And from it, Obama learned an important lesson. You can't propose massive giveaways of American wealth and expect even Democrats to go for it. So Obama's actually figured out something far better, more effective. And I would call it, I do call it, debt as a weapon of global transfer. How? Let's look at it. Let's say Obama has two terms, and he has $10 trillion of debt. Now, first of all, that's a staggering amount of money, right? $10,000 billion. By way of comparison, Bill Gates, the richest man in the world, has about $50 billion. $10,000 billion of debt. Now, how do we ever pay that back? I don't know, but we have to. Somebody else. If we don't pay it back, our children have to pay it back. But to whom? See, it used to be 50 years ago America had debt, but that debt was owed to other Americans. But not now. One third of our debt is owed to foreigners. Sovereign funds, to the Kuwaitis, the Chinese, to the Saudis. So at some point there's going to be a massive transfer of wealth away from the United States toward other countries. That is the inevitable logic of debt. There's no other way to look at it. So all I'm saying is, you can debate whether Obama wants this, but all I'm saying is, it's happening, he's doing it, and it's completely in line with the anti-colonial ideology of global wealth transfer. So at the very least, we could say Obama doesn't seem to mind terribly when debt is escalated. Everybody knows that when Republicans didn't have the House, Obama would have spent a lot more. So, how to explain this kind of profligate behavior on the part of a guy who is reaching the point where other people will come and take his car and his house? Why would you keep doing it? Well, I've just given you a possible reason. So, this is all happening, the facts are before our eyes. I have an interpretation. There might be a better one, but I'm waiting to hear it. Yes, let's take, let's finish up the questions that are here. Go ahead.
This question is on a slightly different vein. As a conservative and as a Christian, I would like to see individuals in developing nations prosper, as well as Americans. As you, I don't believe simple redistribution is the answer. Often we are criticized as uncaring. How can we as conservatives answer the cry of human need without adopting a naive philosophy of redistribution?
That's a very good question, because in some ways, it might have seemed from what I've been saying that I've been offering American exceptionalism against Obama's globalism. But in fact, in my writing, I offer a rival globalism that is actually a better globalism than Obama's. You can see both globalisms in the history of India over the past half century. For the first 30 to 40 years after independence, the Indians practiced what can be called anti-colonial socialism, anti-colonial collectivism. Five-year plans. As a kid, I remember we'd recite things like, last year the Indians grew so many thousand bales of wheat. We were basically little Sovietized kids who were following a model that was explicitly on the Soviet Union. And India was the economic basket case of the world. Then the Indians noticed that the Chinese and the Malaysians and the Singaporeans were prospering, and India began to liberalize its economy. By the way, in some ways in line with ancient Indian ideas. But the effect of it is India begins to blossom, India begins to grow. What's that? Free market anti-colonialism. So today, if you look at countries that are coming up in the world, it's obvious. It's the free market anti-colonialists that are prospering, and it's the collectivists that are sunk in the morass. So the verdict is kind of in. The problem is, I don't even have so much of a disagreement with Obama's dad, because he believed things that were similar to what my dad believed. If you lived in 1950, it did seem that the rich countries became rich by ripping off the poor countries. But today, when the Soviet Union has collapsed, we can look at North Korea versus South Korea. It's much harder to forgive Obama than to forgive his father, because the data is now in. And so I look at Obama far more than a 21st century man, Mr. Multicultural. I see a tragic figure who is living in a time warp. Who is mindlessly echoing the philosophy of his dead father, even though the world has completely changed. And that philosophy is totally inapplicable to the world in which we live now. So, as conservatives, I would say, let's affirm the other type of anti-colonialism that happens to actually deliver prosperity.
Yes. Mr. D'Souza, what advice can you give to white Americans who like to speak the truth on these things, but are scared witless at the thought of being called racists?
I think it's important for white Americans to realize that Obama's ideology is not about race. In a way, he's a race-transcendent guy. And race doesn't matter to him, as it doesn't to me. That's why it's kind of silly that some people have attacked our films with a subtle racial message. Like, where's the subtle racial message? In fact, one magazine even said this got a subtle racial message because they showed George Obama and he's noticeably blacker than Barack Obama. Yeah, the question is about, if we're an empire of ideals, how do you justify American intervention, and how do you justify democratization? Well, first of all, I do think that we should be careful about American intervention. Looking back on it, I would say that if we know now what we knew, if we knew then what we know now, the Iraq invasion was probably a mistake. Its intention was good. What was its intention, by the way? To create a pro-American democracy in the Middle East, in a region that was largely littered with dictators. But when I look at American intervention on the balance, even in cases where we have used imposed democracy, as they say, at the point of a bayonet, sometimes the results have been not so good, but sometimes they have been very good. I mean, we imposed democracy at the point of a bayonet on Japan and on Germany after World War II, and the results have been spectacular. Those countries are not only very successful, they're our close allies. Here's the key point. To impose democracy is not the same thing as to impose anything else, because democracy is a system of indigenous headcounting. So to impose democracy on someone is to impose on them a system in which they, through the majority, decide how they are to be ruled. That's the definition of democracy. There's no other definition. So it's a question of prudence. Should we do it? Is it worth the cost? But if somebody could tell me, by waving a magic wand, would it be better if most of the world was ruled not by dictators, but democratically? If we could achieve it at the cost of one penny, would it be worth doing? I would say in general, yes. Now, there is one massive exception to that rule that's worth considering, and that is that the radical Muslims have discovered that in the Middle East, if you have democracy, they can win. They saw it with Hamas, they saw it in Gaza, they saw it in Algeria when the Islamic Salvation Front won the free election there. We've seen it now in Egypt. I'm still not prepared to write off democracy as an idea, but I'm simply saying that the radical Muslims have now realized that there's a much better strategy than the Al-Qaeda strategy. It's called free elections. So the answer to your question is this. America should be very careful about intervening, particularly when you're using troops. I like, you know, Reagan. I think back to Reagan. Reagan had something called the Reagan Doctrine. What was the Reagan Doctrine? People should fight for their own freedom. We don't fight. We help. So if the Mujahideen are going to mobilize to push the Soviets out of Afghanistan, we'll supply some Stinger rockets and some helicopters. If the Contras are going to fight the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, we'll help them. But we're not necessarily going to commit American blood. And we should be careful about committing American treasure to those conflicts. The difference with Obama is not that he's for or against intervention. Again, it's a great mistake to fit him into the isolation versus intervention debate. Obama intervenes when it supports his agenda. He's isolationist when it supports his agenda. He's not about that. He's about redistributing American power globally. Now, what does Obama want, by the way? Is he looking to, like, crush America? No. What he wants America, he wants a multipolar world, which is the world that was there before colonialism. If we all lived in the year 1500, and I'll end on this, we looked around the world, we would see many impressive, wealthy, powerful civilizations. The most, by the way, at that time, China, number one. Number two, the Arab Islamic civilization. Number three, India. Number four, Europe. Number five, probably the civilizations of the Americas. And you can go on. So the world was like that. No single power dominated completely. Obama wants to go back to that. Now, it's not exactly that way, but I think Obama would be really happy if we had a world in which Russia, India, China, Brazil, shared power with America. America is one power among many. I call it a multipolar world. My argument with Obama, that will be a much more dangerous world than the world in which we now live. People have no idea what other countries would do if they had this kind of power. You take the power of America in the 20th century and gave it to any other country, the world would be a lot less kind and gentle place. So all years ago, and not some other thing.